And he's done a lot of work on demography, and he'll show us some of the tools that he's developed, but also talk a little bit about the undocumented population and the idea of advancing the registry date. And then after that, we're going to shift from over to a conversation about employment-based immigration and labor laws and how we can be thinking about those issues. What's the role that immigrants play in the workforce? How do employers address issues around hiring and retaining immigrant workers? How do immigrant workers navigate the immigration and labor laws? And that's our next two speakers, Shannon Lederer from AFL-CIO and Lynn Shotwell from the Counsel for Global Immigration, are going to talk on those issues, and I'm going to give them an opportunity after Lynn speaks to comment on each other, and then we're going to move into the last two speakers, first of whom is Karen Grisez, who introduced herself earlier. She's here at Fried Frank and also on the board of CMS, and then finally from Phyllis Coven. And Phyllis and Karen are going to talk about vulnerable populations, refugees, about what do we do to protect people better who are fleeing from persecution and other violence? How do we make sure that our laws and policies line up with the values that we as a nation care most about in terms of protecting refugees? And how do we make sure that the immigration court system has enough protection so that people are actually given due process and access to legal representation and those sorts of things in the immigration court? So you'll find more information in terms of their bios in the materials that we gave out today, but we didn't want to spend more time than this introducing everyone. I asked everyone after Bob speaks to give us three or four points of bold ideas for change. And so hopefully we'll hear some bold ideas that will maybe propel us into some comprehensive immigration reform in the coming months.
Thank you. Interesting to be hearing about the commissions. During the time those two commissions were going on, I was at the INS, and our role mainly was to say, sorry, we don't have that. but sometimes we did. Well, I'm going to talk to you today about how we estimate undocumented immigration. And also, I'm going to use as an example of an issue that the data applies to, the idea of updating the registry. And I'll tell you more about that. I started my demographic career at the Census Bureau in 1969. And yes, I was very young. I became instantly the expert on undocumented immigration. And for the first 15 years that I worked, we knew absolutely nothing about undocumented immigration. It was in about 1985 that my colleague and I, Jeff Passell, developed what we call the residual method. And essentially what that came down to was in the 1980 census, there were about 14.2 million total foreign-born counted in the census. And we determined that there were 12 million legal immigrants in the country. Therefore, 2.1 million undocumented immigrants were counted in the census. Up to that point, the conventional wisdom was that, no, they wouldn't be counted. Why would they be counted? The answer is that they are, and that they're counted at a very high rate, probably 90% or more. So that was what we call the residual method, and we used that up until about 5 years ago. Since then, and I'll demonstrate for you, we have made major breakthroughs in estimating especially the detailed information, geographic and social and economic information about undocumented immigrants. Let me So my first thing I'm going to do today is talk about the registry provision and how we use our information to know something about that. As most people here know more about the registry provision than I do, but I've been asked to speak about this. Essentially what it is if you came here, at this point, the law says if you came here before 1972 and you've resided here continuously, and if you have good moral character and so forth and haven't run afoul of other parts of the law, you're eligible to adjust the legal status. Historically, this has been a part of our immigration law, and it was first enacted in 1929, and it was updated about roughly every 15 years after that. And it was updated, and also the period of time that you had to be in the country to be eligible was also about 15 years or so. So after the 1986 Act, however, it kind of got stuck. And it hasn't been updated since then. And so now, it's been, you have to have been here 45 years. So this is now a law for anybody who's 45 and over. And so we have recommended, Don Kerwin and I published a report last year in which we recommended updating the registry date, and also thinking about updating it every year after that. So what I've done is I've worked out from our data how many people would be involved if we were to update the registry. And I made these estimates, actually they're projections of undocumented immigrants next year, assuming that 2017 would be the date of enactment. And so I've worked out the numbers that would be involved. And you see the green bar has about 5 million. So if next year they said, okay, anybody who came in before January 2002 is eligible to apply, that would cover 5 million people. And if they were to say, well, now let's go to the year 2000, that would cover 4 million people. And what you also see from this is, if it were to be updated every year, it would cover about 500,000 people each year. So that's a pretty, and with any luck at all, this won't be considered because we'll have comprehensive immigration reform. But in lieu of that, maybe we could get this through. Now, I'm gonna shift over now and talk a little bit more about our own immigration data. So I've taken the information in the green bar, the 5 million, and I've looked at a few of their characteristics because we're able to do that now with the data that we have. And what we see here, for example, is ability to speak English. 55% speak English well, very well, or only English, and 30% speak a little. So that only leaves about 15% who don't speak any English. The educational attainment is kind of good news and bad news. About a quarter of them have some college or a degree, and about a quarter of them have a high school diploma. The bad news is half of them don't have a high school diploma. In terms of employment status, there would be about 4 million who are employed. And actually, as of 2014, their unemployment rate was 6.4%. 73% of them are at or above the poverty level. And 37% have health coverage. Now, this is just an example of the kinds of information that we have now for every group, for basically every level of geography. And I'll tell you, I'm really going to just summarize how we do this, and I'd be glad to answer questions later. But I want to save a little bit of time to demonstrate how you can go online and get this information. I gave a presentation earlier this year out in Salt Lake, and I made the mistake of putting the website address on early, and basically I lost the audience. because they're all sitting there. Because now you can go on your iPhone and find out how many Chinese undocumented immigrants live on the west side of Los Angeles. So up until about 5 years ago, as I said, all you could know is how many undocumented immigrants live in each state. What's happened since then is about three organizations have followed a new procedure using the American Community Survey. And the American Community Survey is it's a continuation of what used to be called the long form on the 2000 census. Every sixth household got this huge, long form with all these questions. And so Congress decided to get rid of that, because you'll notice in 2010 it wasn't there. So what they did was they continued that as an annual survey that covers about 100,000 people every year. So we took the microdata from the American Community Survey, and we looked at the number of non-citizens who entered the country after from 1982 on, which was about 20 million. And we used a method that Jeff Bessel at Pew pioneered called the logical edit method. And we went into every piece of the data and we looked at every response, and we identified about 7.5 million people that we were pretty darn sure were legal residents. That is, if they were receiving Medicare, if they worked in jobs where they were very likely to be checked or legal, and so forth. So that reduced the number down to about 12.5 million. And then we had some independent population controls for every country, for about 150 countries, that got us down to the estimated population. And by doing it this way, at the microdata level, now we're able to compute estimates for any area and for any data that's included in the American Community Survey, which is a lot of data. And so, this is the website. Goodbye. But I'm going to, Rachel's going to help me demonstrate this for you. I want to show you just a few things and then I'll stop. When you go to that website, this is what you'll see. And what I want to point out is two or three things. When the website comes up, you see State Tool in the upper left. Everything on this page, as you scroll down, will be state estimates. And beside that, it says PUMA Tool, and I'll tell you about that later. But if you scroll down on this page, you'll see a map. If you don't click on any state, but you scroll down farther, you'll get estimates for the entire country. For example, in 2014, our estimate was 10,912. We should have rounded, but we didn't, for whatever reason. So that's what happens if you just scroll down. And furthermore, if you continue to scroll down, you'll get all of this following information. The continent of origin, 25 countries, period of entry, number of years in the U.S., some information about DACA and DAPA, language spoken, ability to speak English, school enrollment, educational attainment, marital status, all of these variables, including whether or not they have access to a computer, poverty status, unemployment status, occupation, health coverage, and race and ethnicity. Now, no matter which page you're on here, you get all that detailed information. Okay, so if you are on this state page and you say, well, we're in New York right now, let's see how many are in New York. It turns green, and you go down and you say 817,000 are in New York. But you're not interested in New York. You really want to know how many live along the southwest border. So you just drag that over, and it adds it all up. And so so that would be 4.7 million. Now, notice right to the right side of the screen, it says Excel. You can download any of these into an Excel file. OK, now I want to go over to the PUMA tool and show you what that does. When you go to that, you get a box that says, find a local area. Well, we're in New York City. So you start typing in new, and you get a choices, and you go New York City. It zooms right in on all these PUMAs. Now, PUMAs are Census Bureau designated areas that have 100,000 people or more. They're just kind of artificial areas, but New York has a lot of PUMAs. So that's New York City. And if you scroll down again, you get all the same information. You find out that there are 575,000 living in New York City, and you have all of that detail. Okay, just one last quick thing I want to do, and then I'm going to stop. I testified last summer before the Indiana Senate, and they wanted me to talk about undocumented immigrants in Indiana. That's where I live. And I grew up in Indianapolis. And I'm going to put in IND because I want to illustrate something for you. So Indianapolis, it zooms right in on Indianapolis, and there are seven PUMAs in Indianapolis. But I grew up on the west side of Indianapolis, and in that left side PUMA. So if you unclick all these, you get the area that I grew up in. And I found out this summer, the largest concentration of undocumented immigrants in the whole state is right there, right where I grew up. And it's about 12,000 out of about 100,000. And it really struck me as amazing. I grew up in this kind of not that wealthy area of Indianapolis, whatever. And then developed this way of estimating how many undocumented immigrants live in that area. I thought that was pretty amazing. Thank you.
So first, I'd just like to thank CMS for the opportunity to take part in a thoughtful and reasoned discussion on these important issues in the midst of the alarming and tumultuous theater that is our national discourse right now. And I wanted to tell you a little bit about the organization that I represent. The AFL-CIO is a federation of 56 unions representing workers in all sectors of the economy and all 50 states. Our 13 or so million members span the wage and skill spectrum. And we are one of the rare spaces where people from very diverse backgrounds come together to pursue shared interests these days in our civil society. And that does not always make our job easy in a policy space, but I do think that it makes it important. So specifically relevant to this discussion today, our members are of all immigration status. We represent undocumented workers, refugees, visa contingent workers, and US citizens. We also represent workers who enforce our immigration laws and workers who provide vital social services to immigrant communities. So our stake in the immigration reform debates is deep and it's multifaceted. And our members have experienced the impact of the broken immigration system in very distinct ways, as you can imagine, across all these sectors. But we have worked very hard to develop a shared fate analysis that strives to reject the divisive rhetoric that's being force-fed through our political spaces these days, and to try to really reinforce the sense that all workers in today's economy feel vulnerable, and that it's only through standing together and pushing for policies that put people over profits and really seek to address income inequality that we're all struggling with, that we're ever going to see the kind of changes that we need. So, you know, we're far from a single issue organization, but our job is to ensure that all people who go to work in this country have fair wages, safe working conditions, are not discriminated against, and have fair treatment on the job. And we know that we can't do that without passing immigration reform. So this is a pretty central mission for the labor movement. And we have a comprehensive framework for immigration reform that has brought unity since 2009 across all of our unions. But because Michele has asked us to lift up only three bold ideas in 10 or so minutes, I'm not going to be able to share all of that with you, but I will just ask you to please understand that the three things that I'm lifting up here are by no means all of the, you know, policy priorities that the labor movement has. And so I'm just going to lay out my short list and then go into a little bit more detail on each of the three things that I'm going to recommend. So first, we would suggest that it is time to create a process to provide deferred action and work authorization to individuals who assert their rights on the job. Second, we would suggest the pressing need to restructure our work visa system to correct the power imbalances that have allowed too many abuses for too long. And third, we would suggest that we need to regulate foreign labor recruitment and ban the fees that make workers vulnerable to trafficking and forced labor. So I'm going to drill down into each of those for a few minutes. And I guess you'll note a theme here. We're speaking about the nexus between labor standards and immigration policy and practice. So I'm going to actually try to refer you back to these amazing data that Bob has shared with us, looking at the demographics of our undocumented workforce. But if we think about it through the lens of the labor market, what's important for us to think about right now is that having 5% nationally of our workforce across all sectors undocumented means that one out of every 20 people who got up today to go to work lacks the status to assert their rights on the job. And we know that if we look at that by industry and sector, the concentrations are much greater. For instance, in construction and hospitality, it would be more like one in every five workers. In agriculture and domestic work, it might be as much as half, one out of every two workers. And then we can layer on top of that the fact that we bring in nearly a million new workers every year whose fate and whose ability to stay in the country, if indeed they have one, is entirely tied to their employer. And what we have is far too many people who have to face a real risk of deportation if they dare to speak up about problems at work and to push for positive changes. And that chilling effect has dangerous implications because it puts a real downward pressure on standards and conditions for all working people in the country. So, I mean, in terms of just real human terms, what does it mean? A landmark wage theft survey showed that immigrant workers are twice as likely to suffer minimum wage violations. Undocumented women were the highest, nearly 50% reported violations. And overtime violations are off the charts, right? 85% of undocumented workers face those violations. So this is stealing actively from the incomes of our lowest wage earners in the country. Data on workplace health and safety shows that Latino workers face the highest rates of death and injury on the job. And in 2014 alone, 846 foreign-born workers died on the job in our country. Okay, so I could give you data on sexual harassment and discrimination, but I think you get the point that I'm making here. These are our most vulnerable workers, and right now our labor agencies are entirely underfunded to address these egregious conditions. You heard the data about the budgets of CBP and ICE. It is 10 times that of all the labor agencies combined, and that's despite the fact that their mandate is to protect 135 million workers in more than 7 million work sites around the country. So our system relies on workers to report violations. That's how it works. That's how any labor law gets enforced in this country. And that is why we need to protect those workers who are brave enough to speak out and enforce labor standards and ensure, and we have to ensure that immigration enforcement can no longer be used as a tool to chill workers' rights. So it is our belief that the legal architecture already exists within policy guidance to extend prosecutorial discretion to individuals who are engaged in protected activity, like asserting their labor and civil rights, or being engaged in non-frivolous disputes with an employer. So what we're urging the incoming administration to do is to clarify the criteria and the process through which workers would be able to access protections that they currently have on paper, but not in practice. We also believe that these protections will be vitally needed whether or not we have real legislative reform, because we know that there will always be people who fall through the cracks for legalization, and so we know that they will be the most vulnerable to exploitation. We also think that it will build momentum and for organizing to win the other kinds of changes that we need if we send a strong signal that if you're standing up for your rights, we're going to stand up for you and protect you. So that's my first proposal. The second that I wanted to talk about is the need to reform our work visa system. And here I think I'm going to provide some different perspectives to those that were expressed in the last panel. So first I want to say that we believe we need to inject some rationality into the process for establishing levels of entry for employment. And so that rather than having caps for various visas that are set by Congress and then frozen in time until, you know, high-paid lobbyists can persuade a reopening of those conversations, we believe that the system for allocating employment-based visas, temporary and permanent, should be depoliticized. And it should be placed in the hands of an independent commission that can assess the real needs of the labor market and determine appropriate number of new foreign workers to be admitted for employment in any given year based on objective analysis and data. And you know, as things stand today, we too often see employer demand for work visas being used as a proxy for labor market shortage. And we know that the two are not the same. Right now, employers have many incentives to prefer to hire guest workers because under our current system, they are able to underpay them. Those workers are not able to change their jobs. And if they're not happy with them, they can, through not renewing their visas or pulling their visas, they can ostensibly have them deported. So I'm by no means suggesting that all employers who use work visas engage in those kinds of exploitative practices. But what I am saying is that allowing those types of abuses to occur erodes the integrity of the entire system. And so we really need to reform the program in ways that will give greater agency and protection to workers, and that should not be viewed as threatening to employers who are using the programs responsibly. And I think that it just needs to be said that the power imbalances that have pervaded in these systems, we have to insist on rights and protections for the workers who are here now and for those who will come in the future. I could provide you with a long list of examples of outrageous conditions experienced by workers right here in our communities who've come through channels that we've deemed to be regular and safe and orderly. So we can't just equate regular migration with safe migration. We have to assess the structural vulnerabilities that are allowing abuses to occur within these regular pathways, and we have to change them. And I know I'm running out of time, so I'm just going to say that, you know, we also believe that these changes are possible, and we know that because we worked with the Chamber of Commerce in 2013 to come up with a different model. It wasn't everything that we had hoped for, but we moved toward a more rights-based and data-driven system that that allowed employer or workers to control their own visa, to come with their families, and to stay if they chose to stay. Low-wage workers. We think that these types of changes are the direction that we need to move for our future flows. We think it's achievable, and you know, we think that this is the time to really reimagine the conditions and the terms under which we're going to invite new people into our labor market. So I'm going to have to skip the third one.
Thank you. So I don't disagree with much of what Shannon said. We may have some difference. Well, like when it comes down to actual policies, we may have some different opinions on the details. But I think overall, from the employer's perspective, we also see a very broken immigration system. So let me just take a minute to tell you a little bit about my organization and the lens through which I view these issues. So the Council for Global Immigration is a trade association, and we work with about 1,300 lawyers and HR and in-house immigration professionals at about 250 multinational companies, universities, and research institutions. So on a day-to-day basis, my members are the people who are responsible for ensuring compliance with immigration laws, either when they're hiring people or when they're transferring them around the globe. And we spend a lot of time putting out information about how do you keep up with this really complex, ever-changing world of immigration compliance. And it's not just in the US, it's everywhere around the globe. We've been around since 1972, and Austin Fragerman was our founder and is our chairman. And in 2012, we became an affiliate of the Society for Human Resource Management. Now, SHRM is the world's largest HR association, and they have 290,000 individual HR professionals in 160 countries. And the reason that we affiliated with SHRM is that we saw that increasingly issues of immigration were intersecting with other employment and labor law issues, such as some of the workers' rights issues that Shannon was talking about with international labor recruitment. And we saw a need to really expand our education on this. Because it's no longer just multinational, large companies that are transferring people around the world. It's employers in all industries of all sizes. And in fact, one of the largest groups that I'm starting to talk to on a day-to-day basis are what we're calling born global companies. So this is an internet company. It started, you know, maybe in somebody's basement, and suddenly they're selling products or services around the world, and they have to move employees, and they have no idea how to do this. So let me take a minute to just kind of talk through the three different ways that our members encounter the immigration system and the needs we have there, because I think that helps explain what, it'll help explain our top three priorities for immigration reform. So the first way that employers encounter the immigration system is through intercompany transfers. So you have somebody who already works for you in one country and they need to go to another country, either for a short-term business meeting, to do a project, maybe it's for a longer-term transfer. You know, and I think if you think back to 1990 when our laws were put into place, this was really, the intercompany transfers were senior executives, maybe at the end of their career, and they were going overseas for an assignment. It would be a couple of years and they come home. This isn't the case any longer. You have companies that have developed business models where they follow the sun. So a project starts in one place, and when that person's done working on it, you know, at the end of the day, it gets transferred to somebody else in the next time zone, so that the work is always ongoing. Sometimes you need to move people to keep up with those business models. You also have companies that are servicing clients around the globe. And so if you have for example, maybe you have an IT consulting firm that's installing a software system for a client that has operations in multiple countries. You're not going to reassemble a new team in every country. You're going to have one team, and that team's going to move from place to place to place to do this installation. And then certainly you have, because of technology and because of globalization, you know, that just didn't exist in 1990, you have offshoring, or what, you know, in our language is called best shoring options. Companies are able to put business, to put their operations in the place that makes the most business sense for them. And sometimes that does lead to, you know, to layoffs of people in a particular country as they move operations. And, you know, I think, again, our immigration laws in 1990 didn't contemplate a lot of these situations. So what is it that, you know, businesses need for intercompany transfers? They need to have laws that accommodate today's business realities. They need to have predictability and efficiency. They need to know if they need to move somebody, how long it's going to take, and be pretty certain that they can get their visas when they need them. And depending on the type of transfer, they often need family unity. Particularly if you're if somebody's doing a longer term transfer, you need to be able to transfer the partners and the children along with them, and they need work authorization and the ability to attend school. Family unity is important, as we all know, for at every end of the labor market. So the second way we really encounter the immigration system is is through local hires. And this is where a company has just gone out into the local labor market, posted the job openings, and the best person who happens to step forward either has a visa that maybe they need some assistance with, or they need a visa. So the most common example of this is a U.S. company goes and recruits at a U.S. university, and what they find in many cases, particularly if you get into the STEM fields and the advanced degrees, half the students graduating are foreign nationals. And in some universities, 100% of the graduating classes with advanced degrees in the STEM fields are foreign. So here you are, you have an American company that has found the best person for the job. They've done a fair search of the labor market, and they need access to a visa. In other cases, you know, maybe somebody who's a refugee or with temporary protected status steps forward, and they have issues with their EAD, and they need assistance with the employer. And then certainly employers encounter the undocumented, whether they know they're undocumented or whether they're using an assumed identity. You know, employers have this population, they have hired them, they want to keep them, but how do they legally do this? So this is, legalization is incredibly important to us in that way. So what do we need here? I mean, we need timely access to work authorization for the people that we're hiring. And employers need tools to verify work authorization. You know, Austin mentioned, we want a biometric ID card. We need something that's simple because, you know, one of the things we do a couple of times a year is we put on webinars for HR professionals. We'll have several thousand HR professionals that listen to our webinar about how to fill out a Form I-9 to show somebody has work authorization. And as clear as we think that is, we get hundreds of questions afterwards because, you know, think about how hard it is in our world. If any of you were to look at somebody's documents, it takes us a little bit of time to figure it out. Well, now imagine you're part of an HR department of one. Immigration and employment verification is something you do along with administering benefits and hiring and complying with OSHA standards and everything else. And it's confusing. So they want something that's easy to administer because they also know that they have to walk this fine line between asking for documents and not discriminating. So we need to give employers the tools to be able to do their part. And then finally, the last group of workers, and I think this is the one that receives the most attention, but is probably the smallest group, is shortage workers. And we heard about the demographic trends that are taking place around the globe and the tremendous competition, particularly for skilled workers. You know, and we're not seeing, I mean, this is not just in the US and the UK, but a couple of weeks ago, we submitted comments to the South African government where they were saying, how do we attract and retain skilled workers using our immigration system? Israel's asked for the same thing. Canada, I mean, every place, we know kind of who's born today, who the workers of the future are. We can predict what their education level will be. And we know that there's going to be a shortage of workers with certain skills. So countries are competing to figure out how do we attract them. We also know we have shortages at the lower end of the labor market. So, you know, in either of these cases, immigration is not the solution. It may be a small piece of the solution, and employers are working on multiple levels. We're working to figure out how do we support K-12 education, how do we work with, you know, schools to put programs in place to make sure that everybody who comes out of school is work ready. How do we recruit, how do we have diversity and inclusion initiatives so that we're recruiting everybody into the labor force who wants to be part of that. But on the immigration front, I think what we're really looking for is we need more visas. You know, we need green cards, we need H-1Bs, we need H-2As, we need whatever the new kind of visas we are that have in the future is. And then we need to balance, you know, how do we ensure that we are doing real labor market tests with systems that are efficient. How do we balance that and ensure that we're protecting and providing opportunities for local workers while also providing protections and opportunities for foreign workers? And I think employers want to be part of this solution. And so we look forward to the discussion. And let me just leave you with one last thought. You know, given that the current system that we have in place was put into place in 1965, the year I was born, I'm thinking about, okay, what's this next system going to be? And how do we not just solve for today's economy, but how do we solve and create a system that's flexible enough to deal with the economy that we can't foresee 20 years from now, but that we know for sure is going to look very, very different than it does today? Thank you.
Michele, you want us to move straight away?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Happy to be back with you again. I want to say at the beginning, my personal work in the immigration area arises out of the management of a large firm pro bono program. So it's mostly in asylum and protection work, family-based immigration work, and some policy work, particularly on due process and access to counsel issues, and within that, particularly for children. So that's the perspective from which a lot of my comments come. Also, we've talked a lot about commissions today, and at the risk of complicating matters further, I was formerly a member and chair of the American Bar Association's Commission on Immigration. So a lot of the work that I've done in the policy-related areas are with that ABA commission. And in particular, some of the ideas that I'm going to talk about came out of a report that the ABA did in 2010 with a number of recommendations for improving the immigration adjudication process as a whole. But although I'm drawing on that work, I want to say that I'm speaking today not for the ABA, but in my individual capacity, and as you'll see too, some of the recommendations that I'm going to make differ a bit or go further than the ABA recommendations. So with a tip of the hat to the American Bar Association, the recommendations that I have are my own. The first one that I want to talk about is actually comes out of a recognition that I think the biggest twin problems that we have in immigration adjudications today are resource problems, which in turn have led to backlog problems. So in any complaining or criticism that I have of immigration adjudications, I recognize that none of the adjudicating agencies have the money they need or the personnel they need to do, with the possible exception of CBP. none of them have the resources they need to do the work that they're tasked with doing. But the backlogs that have been created are a huge problem in a number of reasons. They're a huge problem in the actual adjudication and reward of benefits. They're a problem with affecting removals for those people that really need to be removed. And what I'm seeing recently is that they're now infecting even the State Department work and creating problems in the adjudication and approval even of non-immigrant visas. Which, you know, affects the free flow of people to the United States not even intending to immigrate permanently. One I'll give you, I represent a lady who's now a naturalized U.S. citizen. She called me complaining the other day because her 9-year-old grandson, who lives in Mumbai, got turned down for a visitor visa to come to visit her, and the basis was that he's an intending immigrant. So she called me up and like, what is that about? Well, it turns out that a couple of years ago, we filed a petition for her married adult son, and the waiting period is going to be many, many years. But the effect of that petition for this child's father is that the consulate was unwilling to believe that the child would actually come to visit his grandma and not remain permanently. And they're affluent people, okay? The father is, well, I shouldn't say affluent, but it's not an economic motivated migration. They're scientists, professionally employed. It's not about that. And this kid can't come to visit the U.S. because the backlogs have driven this idea that people won't follow the normal immigration system because waiting the normal way just takes too long. So that's sort of the backdrop. So looking at those backlogs, one big thing that I want to recommend that I think would help adjudication of claims and provide better adjudications, but also take a big load off the immigration court system, is expanding the model that now exists for adjudication of children's asylum claims, whereby even adults in removal proceedings, adults applying defensively for asylum in the immigration courts for the first time, should have their initial adjudications transferred to the asylum office, just like affirmative interviews. And as I said, now children's cases are done under the TVPRA. I think that would have the advantage of having better adjudications, more specially trained adjudicators, but also quicker processing and more trauma-sensitive, trauma-informed adjudication. So it's kind of a win-win for everybody. That it's generally understood that doing that would need a regulatory change when we're talking about how this might happen in a new administration. There's been a perception that that probably needs at least an adjudicative, a regulatory change. There's a slight thought, and if we have time we can talk about it more, that it might be able to be done as a policy basis. But the one thing that it definitely needs is a shift in the finances, because the budget for the adjudication in immigration court is different from the budget of the asylum office, and the asylum adjudications are not fee-based. So somehow there would need to be a shift of resources to enable this shift in workload, and I think, and I invite Phyllis to say more, I think the resistance on the part of the asylum office to assuming this workload is concern about how they could be and would be funded to do it. So I'll say that about that one. The second one I would say is to stop using expedited removal against families, either apprehended near or presenting themselves at the border. Technically, that may require a legislative change, although recently in some litigation involving family detention, the government has conceded that the use of expedited removal in the family context is not necessary. It is not mandatory, and indeed, families from time to time are apprehended with notices to appear issued directly at the border. Everyone does not always get put through the credible fear process, and those families, even if they do currently go through CFI, are sooner or later, generally speaking, released to pursue their claims before the immigration court. So I think just stopping putting children in detention with their parents or without their parents would be a big step forward. Again, would save a ton of money on detention, would lead to fairer and quicker results. And what I like about this in particular is that it would put the focus then on alternatives to detention and cause us to look at what really works in getting people to show up. Because again, in terms of what the resistance is, the typical argument is you can't do this because people won't ultimately show up for their hearings. So looking at alternatives, how much does universal legal orientation program help? How much would it help if people got referred to and connected with a network of counsel right at the border? How about bond hearings and the role of counsel at bond hearings? A lot of pilots like that could help, and studying each of those factors specifically I think would be useful. On that, I'll also say that expansion of the Central American Minor Program, or looking at something like temporary protected status for the Central Americans, would also potentially be very helpful for reducing the caseload on either side. The next one I'll mention is that I favor appointed counsel for all children. I'll say that the American Bar Association has recommended for a long time appointed counsel for unaccompanied children. Let's take as a given that 3-year-olds, 6-year-olds, 10-year-olds should not be representing themselves in immigration court. I differ with the sentiment of some judges that they can either be found competent to represent themselves because they can say their name or even that they can be taught the basic rudiments of immigration law. I say no, children should not be representing themselves, but the reason I'm saying all children is that too often in accompanied children cases, even if the parent, which is typically the mom, is fortunate enough to have a lawyer, the reality is that claims of the children are different and do not necessarily ride on those of the parents and are not on all fours with claims of the parent. So that the child's asylum case may have a totally different basis that's unexplored when the lawyer is thinking only about the parent's claim. And children may be eligible for special immigrant juvenile status as children who have been abused, abandoned, or neglected by at least one parent. And that doesn't only mean the other parent. Sometimes it's the parent with whom they're traveling that may be the one who has abused, abandoned, or neglected them. And that will never be raised by being surfaced from the parent with whom they're traveling. So that's why I say all children should have independent counsel in immigration proceedings. The fourth, because I couldn't restrain myself to three, is an approach for the undocumented population. After the failure of the executive action on DAPA and expanded DACA that we, you know, saw recently out of the Supreme Court, this election obviously gives a big chance to rethink what's going to happen there. And I'd say first, obviously comprehensive immigration reform, or as close to that as we can get legislatively, is the right approach if we happen to get a president and a Congress who are able to work together in sync and there's a chance of getting something through. If that's not the case, we have to return to something that looks like some form of executive action to deal with the undocumented population. The one thing that I learned through the recent Texas versus United States case, even though the Supreme Court did not decide it on the issue of notice and comment rulemaking, if there's a need to go back to the drawing board and start again, if it looks like there won't be a legislative solution, I would really favor starting with notice and comment rulemaking. Open it to the public, get views of the public, consider all those public views, and then do whatever, but remove the argument that rulemaking was not done and views were not considered. So I'll stop there and turn it to Phyllis.
Well, thank you. And before I begin, I want to say I'm not much of a church goer, but there have been two moments during this meeting in which I've just had to say amen. And one was when Susan Forbes Martin said that it's time to take a look as to whether or not the structure of DHS is really the best one for making immigration policy. And Karen made my life easy by picking up about three of my thoughts. So, but I do have a little bit more to say, but before you quote me on the amen, let me tell you who I am and why you shouldn't quote me. I'm Phyllis Coven. My day job is as the district director for USCIS here in New York. This year, I've had a very nice collateral assignment, and I've been able to serve as an executive in residence in the Office of Immigration Policy at DHS, and that's given me an opportunity to touch base with some of you and to engage in some of these broader issues. But a lot of people in the room know me as I was a senior official in the first Clinton administration. And it's from that perspective that I'm also going to offer some reflections as we think about a new administration and the challenges of reform. But don't quote me, because these ideas are really very much personal at this point and do not reflect the current administration. They're not theirs. Reflections on good reform. I was involved in what were the successful 1995 asylum reforms, and I've had to think about what was the environment or the ingredients that made that happen. And pretty simply, we had clear leadership in Commissioner Doris Meissner, who was very focused on it. We had an attorney general who was probably the first attorney general who knew immigration and the importance of it. And after a while, we really had a mandate from the president to do it and to do it fast. And I think doing things on a compressed timeline sometimes carries some advantages. And of course, doing it early on in an administration. I think that's a critical timing thing. We had good brains on it. The INS had hired as a consultant Professor David Martin, who knew the area very well. And we had a great modus operandi that I really insist would have to happen again, which was that we truly consulted. Our method was not just to sit inside a government office talking to each other, but in fact made an active effort to reach out and get the viewpoints and inputs and ideas of really stakeholders at all level. And that really gave us some of our best ideas. And I always believe that users of a system often bring the best ideas for fixing it. And I hope we do that again. Now, we also had a very trusted base of stakeholders. And with them, we shared a common vision. And we had a common goal, which was to really fix the system, which at the time was broken. Not more broken now, but getting there in terms of backlogs and being a magnet for abuse. And we had the common goal of wanting to cure that so that bona fide applicants could be recognized and that the system had integrity. And it was through that, I think, common vision and trusted base that we reached what I always referred to as the grand compromise, which was the asylum clock on authoring work authorization only after the government had 6 months to adjudicate the claim, a process that worked for a long while. But my second reflection, and whenever I see Susan Martin, I'm reminded of, I think, an important failing in that approach and something we needed to do a little differently. We didn't gloat enough that we had the metrics and could prove that our asylum reforms had worked, but we weren't focused enough on them and we didn't scream about them loud. We didn't communicate about them well. And folks up on the Hill really never, I don't know if they even ever did, came to understand that the reforms were working. And we weren't able to change the debate on that. So I think that's another lesson for government officials. You have to communicate about what is working well and when you fixed a problem. Okay, third one, and then I'm done. My mea culpa as a government official, but an important lesson learned, is that you need to be very careful when you're creating new systems, which may not be used for the original purpose in which they were intended. Related to any discussion of asylum reform has to be an exploration or revamping of how we do expedited removal, which has stripped all the resources of the affirmative program. And I know it's shocking for younger people and even old hands to hear that, believe it or not, when we first were talking about expedited removal, we were approaching it as a protection tool. We wanted a mechanism that would allow us to bring in essentially boats. There was a new big industry of Chinese boats run by organized crime, bringing people into the United States. And we also, of course, had Cuban dilemmas, and we had a certain policy about interdiction, but okay. But we wanted to have a mechanism for being able to screen, essentially, boats without having folks come in and keep them in and get into the EOR backlog. And that's what we were looking for in expedited removal. We never thought that it would become an enforcement machine, which it really has. It was first intended to take place actually on the seas. That didn't work out because the bill that the administration sent up got changed and exempted Cubans from it, which was one of the reasons we wanted to use it. And it also created a clause in the Refugee Act for well-founded fear based on coercive family planning, which made it irrelevant for Chinese boats. But the point of the matter is, it was well-intentioned, but it expanded enormously under the Bush administration and is really the mechanism by which the government wants to control the border. And it wasn't intended as that, and it also wasn't intended as an answer to humanitarian emergencies. We still don't have the right tools for that, but the expedited removal needs a serious look, and I hope that happens sooner than later. So it's against that backdrop that I wanted to raise a couple of ideas. And the first was about expedited removal, not a morph of what Karen talked about, but one way to approach it, and again, this is personal thinking, is to try to be strategic about it. Use it strategically, consistent, if we want to be good to the department, with the work smarter approaches that DHS tries to take in many things in recent years. I think we need to explore ER as a tool rather than as using it as a machine. And the options could include limiting it to certain geographic locations, maybe even limiting to POEs, rotating criteria such as age, gender, vulnerability, country of nationality, or other things, rotating it or applying it, rotating it, how you use it throughout the country, maybe throwing some smugglers off, because remember there is that interest in throwing people who abuse it off, and sort of discontinuing it sometimes, putting it in place sometimes. You know, I think there is an argument that that's permissible and falls within the discretion provided in the statute. I am not representing the government when I say that. Maybe it's not. Maybe it would be seen objectionable or arbitrary if we didn't apply it uniformly. But I think that really needs to be explored. And when we explore that, I would recommend as a bold idea that rather than doing things wholesale, as we always seem to do, that we try to pilot our ideas. Pilot what happens if we were to shake up how we applied expedited removal. How does that in fact impact people's perceptions overseas? And also, pilot things so that you can make sure that you can really train the people who are charged with implementing it. And this gets us back to the notion that of my second idea. I'd like to see a DHS protection corps. You know, we have an asylum corps, we have a refugee corps. They focus on adjudication. But they were really, neither was designed to deal with the host of issues that we face, the protection issues that we face, and that our laws have come to acknowledge. VAWA, trafficking, unaccompanied minors. Those have become sort of collateral assignments for the Border Patrol. Well, that's not really how they're trained. And nor do they, you know, say what you will about the old INS, at least folks in the INS understood the sort of migration cycle and that it was a system. And I don't think that DHS officers who really operate in their silos necessarily are taught or understood the whole range of things that go into our immigration system. And pilot things so you can take more time to teach them. But I'd also like to see something like Protection Corps that could work maybe within CBP or everywhere. They could assist, train, coordinate, and evaluate component operations and expedited removal and related processes. Again, it's not limited to asylum. It could be with juveniles, trafficking. And it could enable us to tweak things like expedited removal. Okay, one more minute, and that'll be easy because Karen listed a lot of mine. I do think that it would be great, and I never thought I'd say this because I worked for both HCR and IOM, and used to scream bloody murder about all the duplication in our refugee process, which somewhat I think has been cured now. But maybe it would be helpful in dealing with asylum to partner with JVA to NGOs. And have a system, and maybe it's working in CAM, maybe it's not, where people who are filing for asylum do go to an NGO to help develop the case and somewhat, or maybe even represent them. I think it could serve as a deterrent to non-meritorious claims. It would certainly ease the burden on the program and the actual adjudication. And again, it could be applied to all affirmative cases or just non-represented ones. But there may be some lessons learned from refugee processing, and I think they're worth piloting and worth consulting about and worth exploring. Thanks.
So thank you to the panelists. You guys did a great job at staying on time so that we have a few minutes for questions. I wanted to take a few questions from the audience, and I also want to give the panelists a chance to respond to each other's questions. So do we have microphones around? Kevin has a question, and why don't we take these three?
Hi, Kevin Appleby, Senior Policy Director for CMS. This is to Shannon and Lynn. So I appreciate both your presentations. But in terms of political reality, you are tied at the hip and with the chamber probably in terms of immigration reform. At least that's the perception. Over the last several rounds, 2007, 2013, everyone's held their collective breath as if business and labor could come to an agreement and fit nicely into a broader bill. Having said that, and Shannon mentioned that there had been progress made perhaps in the last round of negotiations, but having said that, what is your view on business and labor coming to some sort of agreement on future flows that both sides could live with moving forward? Because I don't think a bill will pass without some component there, just the way the politics play. So.
Yeah, let's take these three. Go ahead. You go.
Right
there.
All right, for Lynn and Shannon as well. and in the previous panel, there was some discussion again of looking back at '86 and employer sanctions, enforcing employer sanctions, and the challenges of doing that. Now we have, as I understand it, agreement by both presidential candidates on mandatory e-verify. So I was wondering if AFL-CIO is in favor of mandatory e-verify for all employers and what things look like in the business world on that front.
And then Sonia has a question, and then we'll have responses, and then we'll get another round of questions.
Thank you very much. This is for Philip, so for and Karen. Well, given that you were in the whole process when there were a lot of Somalis in asylum cases being expedited in at the beginning of the 90s and before that. What are the lessons that we can apply now on that thing? I remember at that time the INS was trying to do a good job, but also they didn't have enough immigration lawyers or asylum cases lawyers at locations, and there was a backlog. And I would like to get from you that lessons, one. And second, Philip, on your proposal to have a protection agency, how much will detract from the asylum, because the asylum judges, they were not there, they were very qualified. No, they were very qualified, but it was very high, they retired, so the good ones retired. I don't know which one are in the pipeline. No? So how much will work on this protection?
So Shannon,
if
you want to respond first, and then
so in my view, if we have an opportunity for comprehensive immigration reform, I think certainly we can come to agreement on moving something forward. I think both business and labor, we've been working together, perhaps in a way that we didn't 20 years ago, but I think we have an interest in finding solutions to this completely broken system that we have. I think we came around to some agreement in 2013 on the Senate bill. I think that might be a place to start, and I think certainly new issues have come up, so I would hope we could find agreement on that. I think the bigger challenge is not between us finding agreement, but it's getting the House to act, frankly. Let me just address e-verify. I think from an employer perspective, we accept that e-verify is going to be part of any solution. And I've seen that, as it's rolled out in states, employers have tried to figure out how to deal with it. But I think our ongoing concern is that E-Verify can continue to be defeated by a stolen identity. And so as an employer, what we would like to see is more certainty so that, so that the person we're hiring is who they say they are. And that we don't run the risk of that sometime down the road that DHS comes in and investigates and says, no, we know you ran everybody through E-Verify, but they really don't have legal status because they have stolen identities. So what we've been pursuing and talking about is a voluntary biometric option. We've been told that it's technologically possible, but whether that will, you know, play out, I don't know.
Thanks. So I think there's certainly there's room for common ground to move forward, but I think that there are some important premises in this starting point. Like so just in order to just tease out just a couple. So this notion that we need more, I think for the labor movement, what we need is better. Right, and that we're asking the wrong questions, or it's always about numbers, right? And we're not talking about structures, and we're not talking about the public policy rationale for these visas. So, for instance, we would submit to you that facilitating the offshoring of jobs to other countries is not a legitimate use of our immigration system. It's it may serve business purposes, but it's not something that we should be using our immigration system to do. And if we stopped using our skilled visas to do that, there would be a lot more of them available for employers who wanted to bring workers into our communities who they plan to keep here and to build good jobs and stimulate growth in our communities. And those are the purposes for which we understand the statute was designed. And so I do think that we need to have some sort of stepping back to look at the purposes of these programs, that are what purposes they're serving, and to ensure that they're aligned with the larger interests of our economy and of the public good. So that's sort of one side. So there's everyone is open to being at the table and having those conversations, but I don't think that we want to start from the premise that we're going to basically dust off the old compromises and assume that they're the right ones, because I think we would like to see some fresh thinking and new approaches. Just on the work authorization question, we certainly as a labor movement oppose any enforcement only strategy, which we have seen that these things have only served to harm workers. In the context of comprehensive reform only, we are supportive, after there's been a full pathway to citizenship that's broad and inclusive, of creating a fair and effective work authorization mechanism. That would be comprehensively used. In our ideal world, we would take the responsibility for verifying work authorization out of the hands of employers and have it be done, let's say, by a government agency that could give an independent verification number or something like that. But we, you know, obviously there are a lot of people thinking through what alternatives there may be, but we do support, in the context of broad and inclusive legalization, a system for work authorization.
And then Phyllis and Karen, do you want to?
Just quickly, on the idea of the protection corps, I'm saying keep the asylum corps, keep the refugee corps, keep the judges, although maybe we should do court reform. But we need another kind of animal embedded into the various operations at DHS that can train, evaluate, coordinate, inform, ununiformed perhaps. I mean, it's not the most novel idea in the world, and it wouldn't necessarily be easy to do. There'd be resistance, but I think it's really important. We have a CRCL at DHS, Civil Rights and Civil Liberties, and they do a marvelous job, but they're not embedded. And I just think it's an idea to explore. On your question about the Somalis, I think you're talking about refugee camps in Africa in the
asylum cases. I was not interpreting, but all the asylum cases that was here, remember, huge backlog and a lot of asylum cases that came. I wanted to get some lessons from that we can do that.
I have a lesson learned from it, but it actually plays back into the protection core idea. I'll tell you that, and it's especially because you said Somalia, it reminds me of it. I had a chance with the ABA Commission on Immigration, a group of lawyers and judges, to tour the port of entry at San Ysidro. Don may actually have been with us on this trip, I'm not sure. And so the CBP officials at the port were giving us a tour, talking about all stages of the process. They knew who we were, and they bragged that they were breaking Somalians in secondary inspection, keeping them in there for 48 or 72 hours in secondary. These were people who had asked for protection, and the normal expedited removal process, as soon as they indicate an intention to apply for asylum, they're supposed to get referred for credible fear interviews. And so when they said how they're having this ongoing interrogation, and we asked about it, and I'm going to apologize in advance for my language, but they said, yeah, they know that, and they just recently got a big lecture about that from the trainers from the asylum office there who came down to talk to them. Those asylum officers were, quote, a pain in the ass because they don't really get it. And the CBP officials know what's really going on with the Somalians. And if they keep them in secondary long enough, they can break them. And they're the ones that are on the front lines. They're the ones that are really protecting this country. So that is the mentality that we saw. And it was scary to me in the context of who they were saying it to. Imagine what they're doing and saying to people, you know, in the black hole of secondary inspection. So the need for protection in CBP there comes up. And I'll say at the highest levels of DHS, it troubled me tremendously to see Secretary Jay Johnson give a press conference at the border and recently with the Central Americans, recently since the 2014 influx, and say, if you come to the United States illegally, you will be detained and you will be returned. But there's nothing illegal about coming and asserting a claim for asylum. That's why there's an opportunity to do it at the border, and there's a process for that, and that's why people who have crossed the border have a year within which to bring those claims. That's not illegal, and that's a troubling mindset coming from the leadership in the department.
If I could also just add to sort of advice to the next administration, I think it's really important to pay attention to your environment. When we did starter reforms in 95, it was a different environment than when we got IRA in 96. You know, there was Proposition 187 that had happened. There, you know, was welfare discussion. There was the Contract for America. Then there was 9/11, right? And the department was built up around that. And that is the view that the department was built around. So, you know, it's time to take a look at things and be thoughtful about your environment and tweak things accordingly.
So are there any other questions? Let me take this one more. Well, okay, there's two. One, let's take these two more and then we'll break. We have coffee in the back of the room.
My question is for Shannon.
There's the mic right there.
Oh, thank you. I'm Janice Phillips from CGFNS International. My question is for Shannon. You had three recommendations and you weren't able to cover the third.
Good job. Get around my heavy hand.
Thank you, Laura Simich, through your Institute of Justice. First of all, thank you, Robert, for that fantastic data source. I'm going to go right home and look up my PUMA. I grew up in Indiana in a small town, and I can't wait to see Shelbyville. I can't wait to see if there are any immigrants. Secondly, thank you very much, Phyllis and Karen. From the Vera Institute's perspective, we can't, you know, I love the idea of a pilot program or two or three at the border. My question is, what approach would you take to convince the people who would probably inevitably resist the idea of those programs to accept the idea that they could be examined more?
I really think it's leadership. And do it early, and get commitments from people, from leadership to explore new ideas.
Yeah, so thanks, Janice.
Thanks, Janice. You know, my third idea was a more narrowly framed one, but one that we believe could do a tremendous amount of good for a tremendous amount of workers, and that's really to ban the charging of fees in order to get jobs in our country, which most workers across all visa categories, pay, somewhere between $1,000 and $20,000 for the privilege of getting a job here. Many of them mortgage properties, give over deeds to their homes. This is coming in through legal channels, and they arrive here deeply in debt with usurious loans, and as a result are much more likely to accept conditions of forced labor. And this is a well-documented phenomenon globally, and I think it's a national disgrace that we allow it to happen to workers here. The first trafficking case certified under the Trafficking Victims Protection Act was for 350 Filipino teachers, most of them with master's degrees, who were trafficked through the H-1B high school visa program into public schools in the state of Louisiana. This was done by a twice convicted felon, the recruiter was. So that's how far we are from regulating our recruitment system. We need a formal system of registry and recruitment of recruitment agencies. We need to ban fees. We need to disallow abusive recruiters from continuing to use our visa program. We need to hold employers accountable for the practices that are used to acquire workers.
Okay, Bob wanted to say one thing, and then we'll take one more comment, and we'll have our coffee.
I just wanted to ask, did you ever dance with Sue Steele's dance
company? Seriously, I didn't want to say that when I was giving my presentation, one thing I forgot to tell you that's fairly important is that everything that I told you about on that website for undocumented immigrants has a parallel set of data for immigrants eligible to naturalize. So you can get all of that information for all that detail for our estimates of those who are eligible to naturalize.
Quickly, on the recruitment, we have to be even stronger.
I have to tell you, because in the United States, the case is not so extreme, okay? If you see, this is one of the SDGs, it's 10.7.1, reduce recruitment costs, and we are trying to do around the world. Despite you register the companies, despite you register the recruitment companies, this is Bangladesh, Philippines, this is all the Gulf countries, there's a lot of abuses. I interview a lot of the recruitment firms in Philippines that they told me, we settle before we go, the government gives us a fee. So I think that we have to be a global campaign, and it has to be stronger, it has to be the lawyers, it has to be the enterprise, it has to be the unions, because we are trying, we put it as a World Bank, we started putting that, and finally it's in an indicator in.
Yes. So, and just to share one thing with you is that last month in Geneva, the ILO negotiated guidelines and standards. We were part of the workers group to try to set some global move towards some global norms on this really important issue.
And the Journal on Migration and Human Security, we're in the process of editing an article about Qatar that unearths all of the abuses in that country. It's really disgraceful what's happening as the lead up to the Soccer World Cup in 2022. So I think that is an important issue. Thank you very much to the panel. And we'll send you a link to the research to this database and also some of the articles that we published in the journal based on the research that Bob and Kevin, and Don have done.